invitation. Okay, so actually what I'm going to say is this is joint work with George Boxer, Frank Calegari, and Toby G. And there will be a second talk after my talk by George, and the two talks are really, I mean, you should see both of them. Okay. So we've been interested in one special modularity conjecture. So it's the following one. So let F over Q be a totally real field of degree D. Okay, and so there's this conjecture that if you take A over F an abelian surface, okay, and we're going to assume that it has trivial endomorphisms over F, then there exists a pi cuspidal automorphic on GL4 over F, such that the L function of the H1 of AS is the L function of pi S. Okay, so now what are the what is the difficulty there? So the difficulty is that this H1A is not regular. So in the sense that if you look at the odd numbers, so there is the H0, 1 and the H10, then they are both equal to 2, 2. So you have a repetition of the odd numbers. So this in particular means that this conjecture, which at first glance looks like a generalization of the modularity conjecture for elliptic curves, shares actually more technical similarities with Artin's conjecture for odd representations, two-dimensional. Okay, because it's another situation where you have a non-regular motive. So the good thing is that H1A is polarized, and this actually means that pi will arise, I mean should arise, from a big pi on GSP4 over F. And GSP4 over F admits Shimura varieties. So let me be more precise about this. So more precisely, okay, I should say that the fact that this is not regular, this in particular implies that small pi is not cohomological. Okay, so the small pi, you're not going to see it in the cohomology of the locally symmetric space for GL4. But nevertheless, this big pi, we're going to see it in the coherent cohomology of the Shimura variety for GSP4. So this is what I'm going to explain now. So more precisely, so for all v which does not divide infinity, we can define the local L packet, so by thanks to the local Langlands conjecture proved by Gan and Takeda, which corresponds to the Veldolin representation attached to H1A restricted to GFV, and we have to twist by some power of the norm to because I want things to be cohomological. Okay, so we make this twist. So this packet has at most two elements. And one is generic. Okay, so maybe we could call it PVG. Okay, and so there's always one generic element. Almost all the time, it's there's only one element. So in particular, if this is unramified, there's only one element. But it can happen that there are two elements. At infinity, then PV of A has two elements. Sorry, PV. So there's one generic and one holomorphic element. And so these are limits of discrete series. Okay, and they are, of course, determined by, they are determined by the Betti realization. Okay. I could spell things more, but it doesn't really matter. And so we define this P of A to be the product of the PV of A. Okay. And so now the conjecture in a slightly more precise, this conjecture, but now down to GSP4 would be that all elements of P of A are cuspidal automorphic. Okay. And now the good thing is that these elements in P of A, they have cohomological realization in the coherent cohomology. So cohomological realization. So let K in GSP4 of the finite adders of F be a compact open. And so we can define some Shimura varieties YK, which is actually defined over Q. Which has the following familiar description: when you extend the scalars to C and take the associated analytic space, then it's the double quotient okay. So yeah, there's a mild subtlety that when F is not Q, this is not of PL type. There's an issue with the center, but okay, let me just don't worry too much about this point. So we have maybe I will also denote by XK a toroidal compactification. Okay, and so we have automorphic vector bundles. Okay. So these automorphic vector bundles, so they are labeled by some representations of a Levy inside there, but let me be like say the things in the most possible in the simplest way. So for all data KV LV, so they are integers for V dividing infinity. So they belong to Z2 to the D, which the condition that KV is greater than LV, so it's some dominance condition, then we can define, so let me call this tuple, let me call it K, and so we can define the sheaf omega K, which is the tensor product over all V which dividing infinity of the omega 1 A, so I take the So I first take the V part, okay, so maybe extend the scalars, and then, this guy will have an OF action, and so you can decompose it. And then you take the symmetric power there, and then you tensor with the determinant. There's a recipe, it doesn't really matter. Okay, these are the automorphic vector bundle. And so now where do we expect to find these this automorphic form? If we take some pi f, which belongs to the product of all v, which does not divide infinity of the pv of A, then pi f invariant under K will occur in the cohomology of HK with weight 2 coefficient with multiplicity binomial coefficient. So choose Y among D element. So in particular, it will. Which notation? This one, this one, this?
Omega 1A restricted to
V. No, well, I mean that's, okay, so you extend the scalars to the Galois closure of F, okay? And then this omega 1A has an action of OF, okay? So it's.
But what is A?
Oh, yeah, okay, sorry, yeah, I didn't say. Okay, so A over XK is the semi-abelian scheme. Yeah, I'm sorry. I plan to say this. Okay, excuse me. Okay. Is that fine? Yeah? Sorry. So in particular, it's not the same A as this one, right? It could be for some. So maybe, but okay, but let me, I mean, it doesn't really matter. Let me call it A. Maybe it's a matter of cultural background. I learned it that way, okay? CID, but maybe this is not.
It's not known here.
No, it's not known here. So do you want me to write the formula for this? Is that good? The formula is correct, right?
Yes.
Okay. So in particular, you see that it will show up in several consecutive degrees. Okay. So what's the explanation for this factor? The explanation is that you have to choose a pi infinity. And so a pi infinity, which will be a product of the pi v for v dividing infinity. And if you want that pi infinity tensor pi f will show up in degree I cohomology if the number of v such that pi v is the generic choice is equal to I. Okay, so this is why you see this combinatorics. Let me just conclude this introduction by a remark. I mean, so these days people speak a lot about the paramodular conjecture. So what is it exactly? Paramodular conjecture. Well, so you see, you can choose the element. Which is the tensor product of the holomorphic limits of discrete series at infinity, and the generic element of the packet at all other places. Okay, and this guy has a canonical line. Okay, which is generated as follows. So you take the lowest weight vector. West vector at infinity, and you take the paramodular new vector, at finite places. Okay, so there is a new vector theory which is due to Brook and Schmidt. Okay, and this gives you a canonical Ziegle. So a canonical weight 2 paramodular cusp form. Okay, but that's okay. So that's
Brook is the first name, not the last name.
Brooks, maybe Brooks.
Robert.
You think? Maybe Brooks is his.
Brooks is the first name.
Yeah, it's the first. Okay, sorry. Thank you. Sorry. Yeah, I'm not used to. Oops. Okay, so now what's the plan? So, okay, so I've So we have. Yes. Yeah, because I made this assumption at the very beginning that the abelian surface has trivial endomorphisms over, and so it means that all the members of the L packet are automorphic.
I see. Okay.
Okay.
In this.
No, I mean that's for the moment it's a conjecture. No, I mean if. Okay. I mean depends on which order. I mean if the conjecture is. I mean, if the conjecture is true, then it's proved by Arthur's classification that all the members. I mean, there's a problem in automorphic form theory.
The subject of the conjecture you stated early on.
Yeah, yeah. So for the moment, everything is a conjecture. Okay. Maybe I'm using the.
You are saying there is no sign associated to the local.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. That's it. Okay. So. Okay, so now the goal of this talk is to study integral structure in the cohomology maybe omega k. Okay. Okay, and then in the second talk, George. We'll explain how to use this. Okay, and George told me he will give a much less technical talk than mine, so you should not be scared by what I'm going to say. Okay, so this is the plan. So. So now I'm going to slightly change notations. Slightly change notation. So maybe for a while I will assume that F is just Q. I mean to explain the main ideas, I will choose P a prime. My compact, I will write it as Kp. I mean, I will assume it's a product, and Kp is hyperspatial. Maybe it will be useful to also introduce some open subgroups of Kp. So there is the Klingon parabolic, which are the matrices which have this prediction. This reduction modulo P, and maybe there's the Iwaori parabolic, which are the matrices which have this reduction modulo P. Okay, so these are like standard level structure that you can put at P, and I will now consider that my xk is defined over spec ZP, which is possible because, I mean, there is really no ambiguity because I've chosen Kp to be hyperspatial at P. Okay? All right. So now I want to discuss a bit this cohomology theories. And in particular, I want to explain several types of IDA theories. So there will be two types of IDA theories, a classical IDA theory and a higher IDA theory. So, and IDA theory is about interpolating these cohomology groups when k varies. Okay. So I will then introduce two Iwasawa algebras. So let's introduce lambda 2. So lambda 2 is the two-variable Iwasawa algebra. And let me introduce lambda 1, which is the one variable Iwasawa algebra. And okay, and so for any weight, so if I take a weight KL in Z2, then I can view it as a character of ZP cross star, okay, just mapping AB to A to the K. B to the L, And therefore, I can view it as an algebra homomorphism from lambda 2 to 2 zp. Okay. So, so now I can state the classical Ida theorem. So the theorem. This is classical Ida theory says that there exists a finite projective. Projective lambda 2 module M such that for all KL with K greater than L greater than 4, the specialization of M at this weight is the ordinary part of the H0 of the cohomology. In that weight. So maybe now the level has slightly changed at P, so maybe I will be as precise as possible. Okay, and then you have to take the ordinary part. Okay, so this is usually the theory, and so we make interpolation over the full weight space of one cohomology group, which is the HU. And we have this control theorem. So of course, this M is functorial in the level away from P, and so it carries an echo action, and I mean you can work with it. Okay. So now I'm going to state. Maybe I should just make a remark: is that actually this bound is probably an accident. So I mean the expected. I think we should expect that the control holds for k greater than l greater than 3, but okay, and sometimes this can be proved. So that should be the optimal thing. So now there's a second theorem, which is higher Ida theory. Okay, so now we're not going to work over the full weight space, but only on an hyperplane. And so it says that there exists a perfect complex of lambda 1 modules, so that I call M bullet. So it's concentrated in degree 0 and 1. And we have that the control theorem that if we make the specialization of M bullet, so the derived tensor product over lambda 1 in weight k for so this holds now for all integer k which is at least 2 over qp, then this is the ordinary part of the cohomology of x. So now maybe the level at p is the Klingon level, and we are in weight omega k2. Okay. So now maybe let me make some comments and draw pictures. So we can make the following picture of the weights. So maybe it's not there would be a different way to do the picture, but let me do it that way. So we have L, we have K. So there's a critical line which is L equals 3, and then there's a critical line which is L equals 2. And so let me now make some remark and draw the and draw things there. So the first remark is that if you look at the cohomology of say xk with coefficient in omega kl, and if maybe you take the tempered part of the cohomology, so maybe you're over C now, then this is then this is concentrated in degree zero if k is greater than L is greater than 3, okay? Which is basically exactly the numerics we find in the control theorem. While it is concentrated is concentrated in degree 0 and 1 if k is greater than L equal 2, okay, which is the case that we deal with in this Iorida theory, okay? I mean, obviously you can see that there should be commo- at least, well, I mean, then it's a problem of constructing automorphic form, but there should be cohomology in 2 degrees, and somehow this complex is interpolating these 2 cohomology degrees. Okay, so if we make the picture, you see you have this the classical Ida theory, which is over all the weight space, and this is the control theorem zone, okay, which is exactly the zone where this cohomology group is concentrated in 1 degree and actually can be represented by the discrete series, and then on the boundary you have some higher Ida theory where you are now interpolating 2 cohomology groups at the same time. And okay, and so this is higher Ida theory. So now we
this theorem and the Noth theorem is what's the general?
So sorry, what?
What's the most general statement of this theorem? This is for GSP4.
Okay. Yeah. Well, that's. I mean. No, that's. Okay. I mean. Okay. No, it's not, nothing is written more general than GSP4 over a totally real field, mm-hmm. But there's some generality to be found. Yeah, it's true. So I'm going to make this remark now. So in the second theorem we are using QP coefficients. So the second theorem we have QP coefficients. And actually the observation is that we can think of this derived tensor product is some integral structure in the ordinary part of the cohomology of the guy over ZP. I mean, maybe then I tensor QP, okay? But I don't know if it's exactly this integral structure. So it's probably not true actually.
So what do you mean by coordinate structure? I mean, you say not the cohomology, but you're thinking a complex, right?
So yeah. But then you can apply an ordinary projector on the. I will be more precise in a second. Okay. But there's a certain like algebra at P acting, and there's one operator that you use to cut. The ordinary part in both settings, okay? Except that the operator has slightly evolved from the first theorem to the second theorem. But that's okay, but there's a subtlety. But so I think, and one important point and this will be used in the next talk, and George will explain why, is that way we've kind of constructed some integral structure and in the cohomology, which maybe not really arises classically. I mean, it's not clear. Okay, and this is maybe one. This is maybe one good point. Maybe yes. The fourth comment is that. So let M be a non-Eisenstein. So I mean, there's an action of the Ecker algebra, so you can and there are associated Galois representations, so you can speak of non-Eisenstein maximal ideal. Then, if you look at the Euler characteristic of M Bellet localized at M, then this is equal to zero. Okay. Also, this is this is coherent with the conjectural description of the cohomology I gave at the beginning. Okay, namely, I told you that if you start with an abelian surface, then the corresponding automorphic forms should arise in several consecutive degrees, and if you look at the multiplicity, then for f equal q, actually in general, by the binomial formula, you expect that the Euler characteristic is zero. Okay, that's the binomial formula. Okay, so. Okay, and actually it's. I just mean that I think so. Yeah, we can take a weak definition, namely just that the representation is irreducible modulo P. So, I mean, M is an Anna-Eisenstein ideal of the Ecker algebra. Okay, and so you have some representation rho M from GQ to GL2 of FP bar, sorry, GL4 of FP bar, and you just. Sorry, there?
It's no longer congruence is just the Eisenstein ideals, but it also is a various endoscopic thing, if you want that.
Yeah, but I think only there it's fine. Only for this statement, it's just fine to have irreducibility. Okay? So BN may be irreducible. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, maybe I should. Okay, maybe there could be, but actually we can also.
This is if it's in.
So sorry, if it.
If M is in weight Q2, or for any.
No, it doesn't.
If it only occurs in degree zero, how is that?
That can be the case if the representation is irreducible, then it can be the case that there's only cohomology in one. We can.
So there is an action of the Ecker algebra on the complex.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, up to homotopy, of course.
Up to homotopy.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a half theorem to get the bottom theorem, the classical theorem.
Yeah. Yeah, because of the levels I'm choosing.
So this one has some model, but the other one is the not the model.
Which one, the Klingon or the Uwari guy?
Which one are you taking them?
It changes. We can discuss this later. I don't think it's very. I can't tell you. Indeed, there's a subtlety. I see, but I think it's okay. I know it's okay. But you're right. There's a mild subtlety there, maybe. Okay.
Can you explain why you changed from the Klingon to the
Uwari? Yeah, I will. Yeah, maybe this will become clearer in a second also. Yeah, I will explain this actually. Well. Let me just say it in words. Now if you take M to be maybe a non-Eisenstein ideal in the sense that you also want to prevent any endoscopic congruences, then it should be that actually the cohomology is torsion over lambda one. Okay, I think I think it's reasonable to conjecture that. Okay, if you make a localization to prevent any endoscopic congruences, then this cohomology should be of torsion over lambda. Okay, so now let me so these two results they have a parallel. It's instructive to look at the Galois picture to gain some more understanding of these two results. So let me. Describe the Galois picture. Okay, so let's.
Is the definition of ordinary in the two theorems different?
Yeah, it's slightly different. I will explain this. This definition depends on which Ecke algebra is acting at P, and here you see that you have the Ecke algebra for the Uauri and therefore the Klingon. And so there's a small difference, but I will explain this when I plan to describe the Galois picture and then explain some ideas of the proof of these two results. And in the ideas of the proof, I hope I can explain this small difference. But you should think of this as So the Galois picture. So let TM be the image of the Ecke algebra, the image of Ecke acting on M. So this is a finite and torsion free lambda 2 algebra. Okay? Yeah. No, I mean M is not M bullet. So M is just a module. Right? I mean M is the one of classical Lidar theory. Okay? And then M bullet is the one of and then of course we will take up.
Yeah, but in the case of M bullet. This is the image in the automorphism module homotopy or
yeah, I mean yes, yeah. But that's the next. Okay, so then we have a Galois representation. So maybe and let M be call it some non-Eisenstein, but okay. I mean, we can discuss this later. So, non-Eisenstein and PD distinguished, maximal ideal of TM. Okay. So then there's Galois representation rho from GQ to. I mean that's a classical result, huh? So that's then there's a Galois representation rho TM from GQ to GSP4 of TM, so my TM localized at M. And the important point is that you can, I mean, one of which satisfies the obvious relation, but there's one that I want to spell out, which is that the restriction to inertia has the following shape. So the inertia at P, so it's going to be aperture triangular, and the characters on the diagonal are yes. Okay. So you have so you have some characters, okay, and you see from this that indeed the specialization in any weight which satisfies this condition will be ordinary and therefore semi-stable, okay. On the other hand, the specialization at a weight of the form with L is equal to 2. So a weight like this will typically not be ordinary and therefore semi-stable, because so imagine you specialize that, or I think I inverted. Yeah, I inverted. Yeah, no, I de-inverted.
Yep. It was right the first time,
yeah. That's it? And it's K, right? No, it's L, it's a small one. Okay, sorry, yeah. And there, so you see, if you specialize L at 2, then here you get twice the trivial character, and in order for this representation to be Durham, then you want that this extension vanishes, okay? But it cannot be the case, okay? On the other end, over there, we have a second theorem, which is for the higher. So let me denote by T embolet be the image of Ecke in the endomorphisms of R gamma. I mean, so maybe the endomorphism. embed. So I mean, in the category of perfect complexes, then there exists a Galois representation rho t embed from GQ to GSP4 of Tm bullet localized at M. So I still make some non-Eisenstein p-distinguished localization such that rho Tm bullet localized at M restricted to the inertia, or maybe to GQP, as the shape that you first have a block, a two-dimensional block, which is unramified. Then here you may have an extension, and here you have an unramified two-dimensional block twisted by some power of the cyclotomic character. Okay. And there you find that indeed, if you specialize this representation at a weight which satisfies that k is at least 2, then it is automatically Doram. Okay, and so therefore this classicity theorem is consistent with what you observe on the Galois picture. So here, maybe I should remark that maybe we don't quite prove this, but maybe we prove this up to a nilpotent ideal of order 2. I mean, we actually look at the action of the echo algebra on the cohomology rather than on the complex. But okay, anyway. But that's okay. So that's okay. So now I want to give some elements of the proof. So of the proof. Okay, so yes, sure.
This theorem, how is the Galois representation characterized?
Well, I mean, okay, I didn't say it, but it's characterized by the fact that you have the usual identities that the trace of the Frob L, I mean, trace of rho of Frob L is some TL for almost all L. Okay. I mean, at least you prove this. Okay. So the local global compatibility at unramified places. Okay. So let me give some elements of the proof. So the first thing maybe is the so I want to discuss a bit the construction of M and embed. Okay. So the rough idea is that there will be obtained, so they will be obtained as ordinary cohomology, ordinary cohomology of some interpolation sheaf. Interpolation sheaf over some open subset of X. Okay, but actually it's periodic completion. Okay, so the idea is this, that we're going to restrict ourselves to certain open, actually to certain Newton strata in this formal scheme. There we will be able to construct an interpolation sheaf, so interpolating the various weights. Then we can take the cohomology over this open guy, over this open strata, and then apply an ordinary projector. Because of course, before you apply the ordinary projector, the cohomology will be very big. I mean, you're not anymore working on a proper variety. And then all the game is to relate this cohomology with the classical cohomology when you've applied the ordinary projector. Okay, so what are these open subsets. So they are actually given by the P rank stratification. In this case, let me define this gothic X to be the PID completion of X. And so we have opens X greater or equal to I, which is the P rank at least I locus. Okay. So of course Y is 2, 1 or 0. Okay, because we are dealing with abelian surface. I mean, it's a moduli of abelian surface. So now the first observation is this lemma that the cohomology over X greater than 2 of these sheaves, maybe omega k l, and to be precise, we should always put the cuspidal. I mean, but okay, I'm sorry, I forgot it. It's the cuspidal sheaf, but anyway. So this cohomology is in degree zero. So over the ordinary locus, you only have cohomology in degree zero for this kind of sheaf. While if you work over the next stratum, then the cohomology is in degree 0 and 1. Okay. So the proof is in some sense elementary. So the proof is that you show that this X greater than 2 is affine in the minimal compactification. Okay, and therefore, modulo this little game between toroidal and minimal compactification, it's of cohomological dimension 0, compactification. Okay, and while the other one, X greater than 1, is covered by 2 affine. Okay, so that's already a good sign, okay? Because you've produced some open subsets which have interesting cohomological dimension with respect to what we're trying to do. Now the second thing is that so over X greater than 2, you can consider the tight module of the universal abelian variety, and if you look at its etal part, then it's locally isomorphic to ZP square, okay? In the poetal topology. And moreover, you have an isomorphism given by the Hodge-Tait map between this poetal sheaf and the sheaf of differentials on A. Okay? Therefore, this is a GL2 torsor. And actually, it has a GL2 of ZP reduction. Sorry?
Why did that become greater than or equal
to 1? Oh, no, sorry, it's a mistake. Yeah. Okay, so you have here you have a GL2 torsor, which is used to construct all these automorphic sheaves. And actually, over this locus, the ordinary locus, it has a GL2 of ZP reduction. And this is very good because GL2 of ZP now is much more flexible group, and it has lots of representation. And I mean, I'm not going to be very precise, but the idea then is that you can build a lambda 2, a sheaf of lambda 2 modules that I will denote by omega, maybe k univ, l univ, which is essentially like some universal principal series. Universal principal series for GL2 of ZP. Okay? I mean, it's locally it looks like this. Okay. And okay, and so our M will be obtained as the cohomology. So I mean, it's just a zero there because, as I explained, we're over the ordinary locus over this big interpolation sheaf. And then you apply the ordinary projector. Okay, so I will be precise in a second about this ordinary projector. Okay, so now what? So of course now we're also interested in with higher cohomology. Okay, and so if we're interested to capture higher cohomology, we need to work deeper in the stratum. Okay, I mean, because by our first lemma, the ordinary locus has only cohomology in degree zero. So we work higher. So we work over. So for embolet. So now, if we work over x greater than 1, then it's still true that TP of A et has, is of rank at least 1. Okay. So roughly speaking, you have half of this GL2ZP reduction that you used to have. So of course, it's slightly delicate, but it turns out that you can define interpolation in one direction. So you can define some interpolation sheaf of lambda 1 modules, which we denote by maybe big omega k univ 2. And we let embolet be the cohomology over the rank 1 locus of this interpolation sheaf. Okay, maybe take the cuspid apart, and then apply some ordinary projector. So basically, well, essentially by definition, these complexes are concentrated in degree 0, and this one in degree 0 and 1. Nevertheless, there remains the difficult task to relate them to classical modular forms and to prove that they enjoy finiteness properties. So next is to prove that embolet and M are perfect. Okay, so let me briefly explain it for embolet. Okay, and for M, for M, it's already classical in some sense. So, and I want to explain maybe this small change of Ecke operators, and it's also more difficult for embolet. So the idea is to find the relation between with classical modular forms. So, in some sense, we can work mod p by some kind of Nakayama lemma. So we can work mod p, and so you can write this kind of exact sequence. So you have the cohomology of the special fiber with some automorphic sheaf omega k 2, okay, and then you go to the cohomology over the p rank at least 1 locus of this omega k 2, and then you continue, and so you have the cohomology with support in the super singular locus, okay, and shifted. Okay, and it continues. Okay, so now what you want to prove is that this term disappears under some conditions when you apply this ordinary projector. So the we need to let the Ecke algebra act on this. So let the Ecke algebra act. We let the Ecke algebra act. Okay, and specifically, there will be an operator T which corresponds to the double class which contains the diagonal element 1 p p p square. Okay, and this is really this element which is relevant for Iorida theory.
I'm sorry, are you asserting you have an exact sequence?
Yes, I mean just by. No, I mean, it's air gamma, so it's a triangle. And then you apply the cohomology functors and you have a long exact sequence.
But the rank 2 path has disappeared?
Yeah, no, because I'm working with embeddet. So if I work with embeddet, then I mean, it's the usual, maybe, I don't know, it's called excision sequence, or I don't know. Gissing, maybe. Gissing, yeah. Well, okay. So. Which maybe there's, yeah, this was not defined, but I think you can guess that this is the super, I mean, this is the rank zero locus. Yes, that's the rank zero locus. So you are, okay, so we have this Ecker algebra which acts. So maybe, yeah, I should remark that this is not at all obvious that it acts, because you face the problem of defining an action of the Ecker algebra on the mod p cohomology, and I mean it's very delicate to work with the coherent cohomology and to define the necessary trace maps and so on to get an action. I mean it's already very delicate to give an integral meaning to the correspondence underlying this element. But this can be done. And then what we show is that this T, it acts nilpotently. Nilpotently there if K is large enough. Okay? So why is this true? Well, in the end it's really a study of the, I mean, in the end it really boils down to a study of the P torsion group of A when A has P rank 0. Okay, I'm sorry. But in the end, it's really like some you're going to use some properties of this P torsion of A. I mean, basically the thing is that it has no etal or multiplicative groups. That's the key. I mean, it's a tautology, right? It's a rank zero locus, and so you have to play this to show that the Ecker algebra, that the Ecker operator acts nilpotently there. And this is how, when K is very large, you can identify these two cohomologies essentially. I mean, and then this one is finite, okay? Because this is a proper scheme, and therefore you get the finiteness there. And so and that way you can then prove that this is perfect. So then the next task is to prove the exact control theorem. Okay, not just that these complexes are perfect, but really the control theorem with the precise bounds. And for this, I mean, it's again a long story, but we have to relate to overconvergent cohomology and play some games that and play maybe some analytic continuation games like, I mean, that were initiated by Buzzard and Taylor and continued by Kasai and others. But okay, so there are techniques there. Anyway, so now, okay, I have 1 or 2 more minutes. So I just want to maybe explain a bit how we get the results on the Galois side. Galois side results. Okay, So first we consider the classical IDA theory. So we have this representation in GSP4. So, I mean, I claim that we have this representation which has this kind of upper triangular property. And we prove this by using, so the point is that maybe a cohomological automorphic points. Automorphic points are dense in the spectrum of TM M. Okay? And therefore you can use all you know about the Galois representation associated to these cohomological automorphic representations to infer results about this representation. Okay, but of course this is very well known. I mean, was maybe by the work of Taylor and others in this case. So, okay. So now you So now what's really more delicate is to study the Galois representation on M-bullet. So we have this. So I claim that we have some Galois representation on M-bullet. Okay. So, and well, the most delicate point is this property of being kind of, I mean, of having an unramified block of size 2. So two unramified line when you restrict to G cubed. So the way we do this is that we use some generalization of the doubling method. So maybe for simplicity, so let's work in weight 2-2 modulo p, okay. So let me specialize the story to the weight 2-2 modulo p. Then in that case, if I look at this cohomology, so the cohomology of M-bullet specialized at this weight. Okay, then this is, by definition, the cohomology. I mean, it turns out that this is really the definition of this cohomology. So this cohomology over the P rank at least one locus, but with this Klingon level structure. And you take the ordinary part. I'm almost finished. Just give me one more minute. On the other hand, the cohomology of M, so A0, just M tensor lambda 2 in weight 2-2 with FP coefficient, this is this ordinary cohomology, but in a slightly different sense, over the P rank at least 2 locus with Iwari level at P of the same shift. Okay? And so, okay, so the thing is that first we can restrict to A0, because I told you that the Euler characteristic is trivial. And so A0 is isomorphic to H1. And so if we want to prove some statement about the I mean, then we can use this isomorphism, and so we can restrict to A0. And then the thing is that now there are two maps from the A0 of there, so this ordinary part of the A0 with Klingon level, omega 2-2, so two copies inside the space over the P rank at least two locus. So there are two maps and there's an injection of two copies, and this gives two unramified lines. Okay, I mean, so basically the idea is that each of the copies give you an unramified line in the Galois representation. Okay, and so it's a generalization of the doubling method. Okay, except that the argument is slightly more involved. Okay, so thank you. Sorry for being over time.